something, a nice divisor. So that means it should be a co-dimension one sub-manifold. And you also require that it has to be ample. Ampleness says that it is something very good. So some kind of positivity results is implied by its definition. So suppose you have that. So then it compares. So this theorem compares the topology of your ambient manifold with that of the hyperplane section of the divisor actually. So it's sort of, so suppose you know the topology of your ambient manifold. So actually it says that, okay, if you take such a nice divisor, ample divisor, so then you also understand the topology of the divisor, that means a co-dimension one sub-manifold to some extent actually, at least up to homology or cohomology actually. So that is the content of the classical topological left-shaded hyperplane section theorem. And then we want to have such a similar theorem in algebraic geometry. So actually, because this talk is supposed to be meant for a wider audience of consisting of students, so I would first like to give some basic definitions. So not very formally, but try to just give some flavor or give some idea about the objects that we would be discussing about, and try to end the talk stating the theorems actually. So the plan of the talk would be as follows. So I would just roughly talk about what is a topology, and then one would like to look at good topological spaces. So in that respect, so one would look at finite cell complex, so that we don't really want to look at arbitrary topological spaces and look at some, put these questions in that context, but rather restrict ourselves to some nice topological spaces. And so in particular, actually, we would look at manifolds, so which are still much better topological spaces and which is more relevant to studies in algebraic geometry and other related topics. So those we would call as good topological spaces. And now actually when you study an object, so ideally one would like to look at further invariants, attach certain invariants. And so that would help us distinguish the manifolds. So it helps in classification of manifolds. So the invariants that we would attach, rather at least for this talk, I would just discuss about dimension, which one can think of as an invariant of your object, your topological space or of a manifold. And then some nice groups, finitely generated abelian groups, which we would look at are the cohomology groups or the homology groups. So I suppose some of you have at least looked at these notions earlier, like dimension and homology and cohomology, but don't worry. So we would just say that, okay, I mean, starting with some manifold, we attach certain groups. And so those would be sort of something very much related to the topology of your manifold actually. So it's a topological invariant. And now, so this is in general for manifold theory. And now actually we want to restrict ourselves to certain nice objects or sub or topological spaces arising in algebraic geometry. So those are defined using polynomial equations. And so polynomials, and so you look at the zero set of polynomials. So suppose you just start with one single polynomial in say one variable, so you get a finite set of points. And so that comes with some nice discrete topology. But now actually, if you look at a polynomial in two variables and look at its zero set, so it is no longer a finite set, but it is actually, it defines a nice curve actually. For example, if you look at something in two variables, so actually you want to put some nice topology on it, which encodes the information coming out from the polynomial. So this is something what one would look at in the general framework of Zariski topology. So where actually you have every open set is dense. And so this is a special topology which one looks at in algebraic geometry. And it gives more information on the zero set of polynomial equations. And so actually that is more relevant because you can get further more information about the special topological spaces. And now actually, at least for this talk, I would look at the topology of projective spaces and then look at the zero set of polynomials in projective spaces. So projective spaces, you can think of them as compactifications of your complex spaces. So you have, so at least for this talk, I would just look at the underlying field to be complex numbers. So suppose you take some n-dimensional complex space and look at its, say Cn, and you want a nice compactification. So that would be what we would call as a projective space. Just excuse me. So projective spaces, you think of them as good compactifications of your complex n space. Say for example, P1. So this you think of as one point compactification of your complex plane. And now actually similarly, you could look at C2. So then you add a divisor at infinity. So that would be a P1. And then that is your two-dimensional projective space. Okay, so this is what are projective spaces topologically. And now actually suppose you look at, so in your complex space, you look at certain polynomial equations, zero set of polynomial equations. So those would be some subsets of your complex space. And now you compactify inside your projective space. So you would get some certain compactifications in projective spaces. And now one would like to understand the topology of the zero set of polynomial in, equations and their compactifications in projective spaces. So this is what one would like to, so these are certain nice topological spaces, because actually if you just look at some arbitrary topological space, it is very difficult to compute any good invariant for such a thing. There are no tools available as such. So you have to have a handle on computing homology or cohomology groups, which are certain nice finitely generated abelian groups, and they try to say, okay, how, so that would give some information about the topology of topological spaces. But now, so instead of looking at arbitrary spaces, so we restrict to certain nice topological spaces in algebraic geometry, so which we call as algebraic varieties, and try to understand its topology. And the tool is the basic classical theorem given by Lefschetz hyperplane theorem. So this is what, with this theorem compares the topology of your ambient projective space with that of your algebraic subvariety sitting inside your projective space, at least whenever the underlying space is smooth. And now actually we want to formulate a conjectural algebraic version. So that means in algebraic geometry, you are just all this homology and cohomology are certain tools which comes from topology. But now actually, if you look at the Zariski topology, you can also define another group, another certain abelian group. So these are called as Chow groups. And we want to formulate a Lefschetz kind of theorem for them. So at least it is only a conjectural theorem. And there are certain small cases where we know that these are true, in fact. So this is our, this is some kind of attempt towards a algebraic version of your classical theorem. So at least in the, so in the last 5 minutes, I might just state the conjectural version of this Lefschetz hyperplane section theorem in the in relation to Chow groups. Okay, so this is some overview. So let us start with some basic notions. So what is topology? So actually Rama Mishra is an expert in topology, so she might say more about it. So I'll just say that for a layman, a layperson, like what this is about. So topology for me, and as such, like if I have to tell it, teach my daughter or somebody, like, what is topology? I would just say that, okay, it is a study of spaces actually. So with the requirement that properties like stretching, bending are preserved, but not tearing. Okay? So I'm not really going to go into what to into proper definitions, but at least say that, okay, this is something, but at least motivate with certain examples actually. So motivate in the sense that at least these are some examples you keep in mind, and the rest actually later you just look into the proper definitions which are there in hundreds of books actually. Or actually you should ask Rama actually, who is already here. So okay, so the first examples which we see are the usual Euclidean spaces. So for example, the real numbers, so this is the one-dimensional real line, and we all know that this comes with a distance function. And now actually if you look at the two-dimensional real plane R2, and then you have the R3, Rn. So all these are topological spaces with the topology prescribed by the distance function or the metric function. So usually I think people say that this comes with a metric topology. But okay, so these are some nice standard examples. And now actually we want to look at certain non-Euclidean topological spaces. So this first examples which one thinks about are circle, the donut or torus, and the sphere. So these are good examples of non-Euclidean topological spaces. So these are not, these don't have a distance function, but then there are other ways one can put a topology and try to understand them. So we want to restrict our attention to good topological spaces, like what we just saw before, circle, donut, or torus, or sphere. So in that sense, so what is good actually for us? So we just look for what are the building blocks of good topological spaces. So firstly we see what is it that works in Euclidean spaces. So what is it that the metric does actually for us? So what we do is that borrow good pieces from Euclidean spaces and patch them together. And we would like to call them as good topological spaces. So the good pieces in zero dimension is just a point. And now actually if you look at in one dimension, in your real line, so you just look at the unit interval. And if you look at good pieces coming in R2, so this would be the unit disk. So that means the points with distance less than one from origin. And now actually if you look at the unit sphere, so this is your usual sphere in R3. So this is consists of points with distance less than one from origin. So these are called as standard open cells actually. So this is just a definition. I mean, you can call it whatever you like, but usually one would call them as open cells. Just as if you look at in Rn, you would call them as open balls. In certain texts, actually they are called as open cells. We would call them as open cells because actually we are we want to introduce this finite CW complex as such. So that's why we call them as cells actually. So good topological spaces would be a finite cell complex M, which looks like a finite disjoint union of open cells of varying dimension. So in other words, just think of, so we have seen what our building blocks should look like. So we said that it should look like a point, so or a unit in open interval, or you take a open disk, or you can take an open sphere, and so on. So actually you can do that in each dimensions. So actually you just take some collection of such things, and there is, and you just join them together in, but you it should be a finite disjoint union. You don't want an infinite number of such cells. So just take a finite collection of open cells in of any dimension you want actually. So then you just put them together, and then you call it as a finite cell complex. That's all. And now you can put a topology on such a finite cell complex also, on this disjoint collection actually. So there is a way you can do that. So this is what one would call as good topological spaces. So now actually if you look at the previous examples, so you just look at a circle. So this is a finite union of an open interval and a point. So that is a disjoint union of one-dimensional open cell and a zero-dimensional cell. So it has only two components in dimension zero and in dimension one. Now if you look at a sphere, so it is a disjoint union of a two-dimensional open cell and a zero-dimensional cell. So now again, this is a disjoint union of cells in dimension 0 and in dimension 2. So now if you look at torus, so it has cells in each dimension. So that means it has one two-dimensional cell, two one-dimensional cell, and a zero cell. That means a point. So there is a way you can think of your torus topologically as a finite collection of these cells. So a basic invariant of these topological spaces is dimension. So how do you define dimension for this finite cell complex? So it is the largest dimensional. Just a minute. So it is the largest dimensional constituent cell of the space. So actually, as we said, that for these topological spaces, so it is a disjoint collection of cells in different dimension. Look at the largest dimensional cell and you take the dimension of that cell to be the dimension of your CW complex. So this is how you define the dimension. So now you want to, once you have defined a certain object, you want to attach certain invariants. So the first invariant, which was defined, I think, I don't remember the time period, timeline, but at least it's called attributed to Euler. So, and it's called as the Euler characteristic class. So this is basically the alternating sum of the number of k dimensional cells. So this is called as the Euler characteristic class. So now actually, if you take a two-dimensional polyhedron and you take B to be the number of vertices, E to be the number of edges, F to be the number of faces, then the Euler characteristic is going to be the Euler. So this is the vertices would be the number of zero-dimensional cells. The edges would be the number of one-dimensional cells and F would be the number of two-dimensional cells. So you are taking the Euler, the alternating sum. So this is how it would look like. Now the circle, it is going, it consists of a one-dimensional cell and a point here. So the Euler characteristic turns out to be zero. So similarly for a sphere, it can be thought of as a disjoint union of a two-dimensional cell and a point here. So you don't have anything in dimension one. So this is not there. And then you get it to be two. So for torus, you would get it to be, you can write it as a two cell and then two one-dimensional cell and a point here. So the Euler characteristic turns out to be zero. So these are certain nice invariants. The first invariants that were defined. Now we would like to look at certain topological spaces, which are still better than finite CW complexes. So where we would like to understand, because manifolds, where one would like to actually study the geometry. So that's where this motivation comes from. And so manifolds are topological spaces, which locally look like open cells of same dimension and without sharp corners. So actually in finite CW complex, we saw that you can have cells in different dimensions. But now we want to restrict our attention to topological spaces where you can actually write it as union of open cells. But actually it should look a smooth object. It should not have a sharp corner. So for example, we looked at circle. So locally it looks like pieces of arcs actually. So if you take any point on the circle, you can always find a small neighborhood which looks like an open interval and patched smoothly actually. So here patched, here I mean it should be smoothly patched. Actually, we don't want it to be patched in a different with curves and so sharp corners. Now suppose if you take a sphere, locally it looks like an open disc patched together. Now if you take a cone, so it is not a manifold. It has a sharp corner at its apex. So this is not a manifold. So now if you take a cylinder or drum, so this is again not a manifold. At the rim, it does not resemble an open disc here. So if you take an open at the rim, you take any point there, so actually it would look like you can imagine. So it is not going to be smoothly deformed to an open disc here. So that's why actually it has a problem at the rim. So it is not a manifold. So these are certain examples. So now actually in algebraic geometry, we are interested in affine spaces and in projective spaces. So these are certain nice, very nice examples of manifolds also. So the first example is the projective space. But I just want to say that the projective space is a special kind of a Grassmannian manifold. So if you look at a Grassmannian manifold, so that means, so the definition says that, so this is a finite cell complex and it parametrizes R-dimensional subspaces in your N-dimensional complex space. So that means now suppose you take, so what it says is that you start with some complex N space. So now you look at the collection of all R-dimensional subspaces there. So basically it has to contain the origin firstly. And now actually you just, for any subspace, you think of it as a point in some space actually. And so you take the collection of all this. So this would be what would be called as your Grassmannian variety or Grassmannian manifold. So firstly, it is only a parameter space, but there is a way to put a topology on it. And moreover, a manifold structure to make this parameter space a manifold here. And so once it is a manifold, you can also define its dimension. And it happens to be R times the difference, N minus R. So that is the dimension of this Grassmannian manifold. So the simplest case would be when R equal to 1. So that means you are just taking your complex N space and then you are looking at lines through the origin. So each line through the origin, you think of it as a point in some variety. So that means you have a parameter space. So where each point in that parameter, it parametrizes a line through the origin. So that's why it is called as a projective space. So think of that, think of it this way, that you have a single point in space, and then you can project it from a, you put some light there, and then you see some lines through the origin, and the base you think of as a parameter space where you have lines joining a single point with your floor on the floor, points on the floor. So this is called as a projective space. So it parameterizes the lines through the origin in your any complex N space, and it has complex dimension N minus 1. So for example, when N equals to 2, P1. Is the usual two-dimensional sphere we could recall previously. So now what is the, so we are interested in understanding the topology of this projective space. So what is the cell decomposition of projective space? So think of it like this. So now you take your complex plane. Okay, so take the complex plane and then add a point at infinity. So what you get is P1. The projective line. Okay, so this is, so P1 is going to be the one point compactification of your complex plane. So now if you take P2, so P2 would be, you take C2, your complex two-dimensional space, and add P1 at infinity. So it is a disjoint union of C2 and P1. And you put a topology on it, and then what you get is the projective two-dimensional space. And so on. So you can actually do it for your Pn minus 1. So where it is topologically looking just like a Cn minus 1, and then you add a Pn minus 2 at infinity. And then you take that disjoint union and topologize it, and what you get is projective n minus 1 space. So this is how it would look. And in fact, you can write, have a stratification of Pn of your projective space. So you have P0 sitting inside, P0 is just a point sitting inside P1, and P1 sitting inside P2 and so on. So actually now if you look at person to understand the topology, we have to see the stratification, how the difference looks like. So if you remove one stratum, so what is the complement here? So if you look at P1 and you remove the point, so that means in P1, point is removed, so what you get is C2. So that is an open 2 cell. So now if you look at P2 and you remove P1, so what you get is an open 4 cell. So just remember that when I write 2 cell, it is actually the real 2 cell, because P1 minus P0, as I said earlier, it is going to be C, complex plane. So that means it is real 2-dimensional cell here. And then you take P2 and you remove P1. So what you get is C2. So C2 is actually an open 4-dimensional cell. So in this way, we conclude. So you can do it, iterate this process. And what we conclude is that your projective n-1 space, so this is a disjoint union of even dimensional cells of dimension less than 2 times n minus 2. So topologically, this is how your projective n-1 space looks like. So at least by using the construction of projective space, we have understood the topology of projective space. So now actually we want to understand certain nice manifolds embedded inside your projective space. So this would be what would be of interest to us. See, because in maths actually you can define all this, make lot of definitions, but it is very difficult to actually compute any object actually. Like somebody says, okay, you have all these topological spaces, but if you ask, okay, you just take some object in your house and ask how is the topology looking like? So it's very tough to understand what are the tools available to obtain such things, to get some results on them. So you would restrict your attention to some smaller, nicer looking objects, smaller class of examples, and try to see how you can get some handle on them. So that is why these theorems are useful, because they actually at least give some general statement that, okay, you have certain polynomial equation or a hypersurface in projective space. So there should be some way of computing, a way of comparing the topology of your ambient space with that of your underlying, with that of the embedded manifold section. So that's the beauty of these theorems. And so motivate them. So let us now start looking at some simple looking sub-varieties or hypersurfaces. So now suppose you look at a polynomial in one variable. So the zero set has only 2 points since the degree is 2, because we are all working on complex numbers. And now suppose you look at a polynomial of degree n. So this has n roots or zeros, which may or may not be distinct. So the zero set of these polynomials in one variable, so this is just a finite set of points. So this is not of much interest, because now you know that it is made, the topology is just consisting of a finite set of points actually. So you know that they are all made up of zero dimensional cells, a finite number of them. So that's it. So now actually if you look at polynomial in 2 variables, so this is what we express them, an b0 xn plus an minus 1 b1 and so on. So this is polynomial in 2 variables and the coefficients are complex numbers. So now you look at the zero set of this single polynomial. So that means you look at the pair of points s comma t in your complex 2-dimensional space, which fulfill this above equation. So you look at the zero set, so actually it defines a nice curve in a complex plane actually. And so we can ask curve is actually a 1-dimensional object. So in real dimensions, it is of dimension 2. So one can still ask, what is the topology of this curve here, right? So how can you find out how the topology, this finite cell decomposition looks like. So continuing, we can look at a finite set of polynomial equations. Now, actually, it may not be just in a single variable, but you look at n number of variables and look at its common zero set. So this is, we denoted the common zeros, we denote by Z of F. So F is a finite collection here. It's a finite collection of polynomials in n variables. And so you look at the common zeros would mean that you take, look at all those points in Cn, that is an n tuple, and plug it in each of this polynomial, and then the polynomial has to vanish at that point, each of this polynomial from this index set. So that is what I mean by common zero set. So you look at, so that forms a nice subset of your complex n space. So actually a priori it is only a subset, but this Zariski topology precisely say that, okay, call this Z of F as a closed subset. So that means you put a topology on Cn by calling all this Zf as closed subsets. So there is a topology on Zf. So now the question is that this is also some kind of a topological space, because your Cn, it comes with a Euclidean topology. So this is a subset there. So this also comes with a Euclidean subspace topology. And now actually, so this is a topological space actually, for whatever topology you want to consider. But then you want to understand the classical Euclidean topology of Zf. That means, can we understand the finite cell decomposition for Z of F? Why this is interesting is because we know the topological structure of Cn, right? This is okay, it has only one cell in dimension n. So what about Cf, Z of F here? So a priori it is not at all clear actually how can we compute the finite cell decomposition of Zf. So there is no handle on it. So we have to get some method to at least get something. But what information we have is that it is defined by certain polynomial equations and it is sitting inside Cn. So is there a way to compare the topology of Cn with that of Z of F? So that is what one is leading to. So describe the space Z of F, that is understand the properties, that means the self-finite CW complex in terms of geometry and topological invariance. So for this purpose, so for to understand this question, so we have to go to the realm of algebraic geometry. So it is easy to pose this question actually. I mean, you have such a subset Z of F. So how can you describe the cell decomposition of Z of F? So, but for that, there is no direct answer. So you have to understand the algebraic geometry behind it. So what do you do then? So firstly, you have to look at smooth compactifications embedded in projective space. So instead of looking at Cn, you compactify Cn first. So the compactification of Cn would be what? You are going to add a Pn minus, a projective space of dimension n minus 1 at its boundary. And what you get is your projective space Pn, that means your n-dimensional projective space. So there you compactify Cn. And you have this subset Z of F. So you just take its closure in P of N. So you would get something like Zf bar. So now you have gotten a subspace Zf bar in the compactification of this guy. So this is Pn. And Pn, we know again what is this cell decomposition. And now you ask, is there a way you can say something for Zf bar, the closure of Zf bar in Pn? Because once you know how this looks like in Pn, so that is good enough to understand the topology of Zf also. Okay, so for this purpose, so again, actually to apply all these theorems, we have to restrict our attention to smooth Z of F. So that means when we define, when we define this Z of F, we have to add the zero set here. actually. So you have to assume that it is smooth. So actually, so now you see the complexity of this problem. But when z of f is not smooth, we really don't know either actually how one can make some comparisons or how to find its cell decomposition here. But so we have to again restrict our attention to smooth z of f, and even its compactification in Pn, that also we need to assume it is smooth. So only in such cases there is something one can say about the CW complex or the decompositions to some extent. So we have to assume that the common zero set is smooth, that is, it is a manifold, and then we want to understand its cell decomposition and also determine its invariance. So the first step, as I just said, is to compactify, and then require that the compactification is also a smooth manifold. So the smooth compactification of your n space is projective space, and you can look at smooth compactifications of z of f. So you can look at, so there are certain theorems which says that smooth compactifications can be embedded in a large projective space. So the question is to understand the topology of ZF bar. So this is what one would first like to understand. So what is, so let us, instead of looking at an arbitrary collection of hypersurfaces, polynomials, let's look at a single polynomial equation. And let us try to understand the question in that case first. So just start with a single polynomial equation, call it Fj, so that it's a polynomial in n variables. And now look at its zero set in your complex n space. Because here I'm not assuming that this is a homogeneous polynomial also. And now actually you have Zf inside Cn. So now you compactify both the spaces simultaneously. So this is, so there is a process to do that, and that is called as homogenization. And so now you have Zf bar inside Pn, and assume that the compactification, so this is a smooth manifold, and we want to understand the topology of Zf bar in this situation. So that means f is just given by a single polynomial, not by a collection of polynomials. So we have already seen the topology of your projective space. So now there is a comparison of topologies of your projective space and that of the hypersurface. So this object Zf bar I would call as a hypersurface, where we assume that it is again a smooth hypersurface. The hypersurface is because the dimension of Zf bar in this situation, when f is given by a single polynomial, it is one less than that of your ambient projective space. So in this case, this your projective space has dimension n, and then this hypersurface has dimension n minus 1. So we want to have some kind of comparison between the topologies of Pn and with that of the hypersurface. So recall that we just defined a topological invariant, which was the Euler characteristic. But now actually one can also look at define certain finitely generated abelian groups, which we call as your cohomology groups, and also homology groups. And so actually just for this talk, remember that because for a finite CW complex, you can define these groups in a range between 0 and 2 times. So these are certain abelian groups where we would just look at the underlying real structure of your manifold. So in this case, this is Zf. So this is of complex dimension n minus 1. So it is of real dimension 2 times n minus 1. So that's why you have your cohomology groups, which is in the range between 0 and 2 times n minus 1. So you have a collection of finitely many abelian groups, which are again finitely generated. And say H0 and up to H upper 1, H upper 2, and so on, up to H upper 2 times n minus 1 in this case. So these are what are called as the cohomology groups. So these are finitely generated. So actually what you should remember here is that about these cohomology groups or your homology groups is that it basically tells you that what are the cells in say H upper zero. So H upper zero is going to tell you what is how many top dimensional cells occur in your manifold. So H upper one will say that how many that whatever is the dimension minus one cells occur in that manifold. So it gives information about the number of such cells and your and basically it is generated by such cells. So that is how you can remember this cohomology. So actually understanding the finite series complex is it suffices to know what are the cohomology groups, because then you know how many such constituent cells are present in that manifold. So that's why these are very important groups. So that's why this theorem, Lefschetz theorem, is very relevant in that situation, because it actually gives a comparison between the cohomology groups directly. So these are finitely generated abelian groups. And for example, if you look at the projective space, so what it says here is that only the even dimensional cohomology groups is generate that constituent cell in that dimension, and it is zero in odd dimensions. So basically we have seen that your Pn, the number of cells we have seen are just in even dimensions, and your cohomology group is just generated by those even dimensional cells. Even dimension, you just have one constituent cell. So that's why this group is generated by that constituent cell in that even dimension. Otherwise, in odd dimensions, it is zero. So this is the cell decomposition of your projective space. And this is how the cohomology groups of your projective space also looks like. So what does the Lefschetz, classical Lefschetz theorem say? It says that so there is a restriction map from the cohomology group of your projective space to the cohomology group of your hypersurface with Z coefficients. And it says that, so this restriction map is an isomorphism for R strictly less than N minus one. So that means this is the dimension of your Z of your hypersurface. So this is actually an isomorphism. So in other words, it says that in this range, when your R is actually less than the dimension of hypersurface, whatever constituent cells are there for your projective space, they just map to the constituent cells of your hypersurface. So, and you don't have any more than that. So that means the topology in this range, if you look at your finite CW complex and you stratify it according to the dimension of cells, it says that the same cells actually generate the finite CW complex up to that skeleton. So that skeleton of your finite CW complex remains the same in dimension Rth skeleton of your hypersurface. It's basically coming from your ambient projective space. So actually, your finite CW complex, you can call stratified according to its dimensions and you call them as your skeleton, which consists of cells only in that particular dimension. So it says that that skeleton remains the same. It comes from your projective space. And actually, when R equals to N minus one, so you just have an injectivity. So they're only in this dimension. That means the dimension of your hypersurface, there can be more cells coming actually. So that's what it says. And otherwise, in other range, it is just the same topology. So this is very useful and very important also in topology, that it just gives a very good comparison of how to and helps you to compute the topology, the finite CW structure of your hypersurface, at least smooth hypersurfaces. That's what is useful for us. Okay, so now in the last few minutes, let me say why this is, so this is something classical, and in algebraic geometry, what do we do actually? So actually there is something called as an algebraic cohomology, encoding algebraic structure. So what are called as Chow groups? So just as in your usual topology, you are looking at, when you define homology or cohomology, so you are looking at subspaces in smaller dimensions and then try to define all these cohomology groups. So similarly, actually in algebraic geometry, you replace all these closed subspaces by closed sub-varieties and put some, so basically you look at the Chow group will mean that, so this notation, so forget this C, so this is sort of cohomology. So what I mean here, the CHRZ is saying that you look at closed sub-varieties of Z. So Z is any hypersurface for us. Closed sub-varieties of Z. Variety, I mean that, again, it should be given by polynomial equations. You are not looking at arbitrary subspaces. By, again, given by further polynomial equations, and the zero set sits inside Z. And it has dimensions. So look at sub-varieties of codimension R. Look at the free abelian group generated by them. And then you have to put an equivalence relation. So what is called as rational equivalence. Okay, so at least for this talk, just remember that there are this for any algebraic variety, for in particular for Z, you can define an abelian group, which we call as Chow group. So it is not, need not be finitely generated. So it can be, most often this is infinitely generated. So you can define these Chow groups. So these are also certain invariants associated to your hypersurface, which takes into account how it is defined. That means it is defined by polynomial equations. So that's why I wrote it as algebraic cohomology, because it says that, okay, you are looking at the polynomials here. So now there are certain restriction maps coming from your Chow group of your project, ambient projective space, to the Chow groups of your hypersurface. So Norrie's conjecture, so this is again a conjecture. That means we don't know the full result, strength of the result of the conjecture. So this says that, so this should be just as we saw it for for the classical left shifts. So this should be an isomorphism for R less than n minus 1, that is the dimension of your hypersurface, and this includes when R equal to n minus 1. So for this, he assumed that the hypersurface Z should be very general. So this should not be true for any smooth hypersurface, but very general and for very high degrees, this should be true. So it is something, there are certain conditions, but this is still okay. I mean, this is something one doesn't know much about, but at least this will say that there is some kind of connection with the classical Lefschetz theorem, at least for hypersurface, very general and of large degree. So actually one can also propose dual versions. So your classical Lefschetz says that there is a push forward. So just as we define cohomology, so the dual version would be the cohomology groups, and then you can so once you have dual versions, so you would look at the push forward maps. So ZF sitting inside PN. So these are the homology groups. So this is an isomorphism for K less than N minus 1. So if you look at the push forward, so at this point you would require surjectivity. And then conjecturally, one would say that, okay, you look at the Chow groups instead of your homology groups. And then say that this is instead of so this is injective whenever k is bigger than 1 for very general and for sufficiently large degree, and for a smooth hypersurface you have something a bit stronger actually. So for any smooth hypersurface, so these are certain homological versions of the conjecture. So at least we know a few examples, small cases where this result is true actually. So this is some joint work, recent joint work. So I think I'm done. So I'll stop here at this point and invite questions from all of you.
Yeah, thanks the speaker. Any questions? I think there is one over the chart. Let's see. So it's a question from Manish Keshekar. How to imagine those cells in spaces?
Cells actually, so actually if you look at this example, like circle, right? So circle, donut, torus. Okay, so you have R, the real line. So the one dimensional cell is just the open interval with centered, say you can take the unit interval, unit open interval. So in R2, you are just taking the unit open disk. R3, you can take the unit sphere, actually open sphere. So if you look at the circle, so circle, where is it? So circle actually, if you take, so this you can think of as, you just take a point away from your circle. So then what is left is just going to be something open here, right? Endpoint. So that actually you can always decompose an open interval. See, because in topology, as we said, that you can just you can stretch it, bend it, whatever you want, you can do it actually. But you cannot just tear it. That means you cannot make pieces out of it. So I can, so suppose if I take a circle like this and remove a point, so then what is left is something like this. So this I can bend it, stretch it, and make it look like an open cell actually. So what I get is an open cell and a single point. So that is what we mean here when we say that circle is finite union of open interval and a point. So similarly, if you take a sphere, so this is actually, if you take a sphere, so that means something like a ball you take, and which is a hollow ball, and then you puncture it. Once you puncture it, so that means you have removed a point, that means a zero dimensional cell. So what is there? So then you flatten it. So once you flatten it, what do you get? You get an open cell. Right? So think of as an open two-dimensional ball, and then you how do I say, you turn it around and then add a point, glue it at this point here. And you can make a sphere out of it. And similarly, think of how you can make a torus from all this two cells, and the zero cell. That I leave it as an exercise. So just take a torus, a donut, and see how you can break it into pieces. You can stretch and bend and whatever you like to do, you can do. Just to see that you can express it in this term section. So
there is one more question from Shyam Gupta. So could you please explain the topological invariance of cohomology groups?
So topological cohomology groups. So actually you think of, so firstly, maybe it is useful to look at cohomology groups. So actually if you look at any textbook in topology, so they would say there are two ways to define your homology and cohomology. One is, I think, use the singular homology, and then the other one is the simplicial homology. You look at the finite simplex, and look at certain simplices in certain dimension and define boundary maps, form a complex of simplicial groups, and take the homology there. So this is the standard way. But intuitively, how do you think of homology or cohomology? So cohomology, for me, I always think of them as dual of homology groups. So homology, I mean H lower R, like I think I put it here. Right, so H lower K. So this indices, if I put it below, I would call them as homology. And cohomology would mean that something put it above here. So for me, actually, I always think of cohomology as dual of homology groups, at least with some coefficients are rationals or something, at least for nice spaces. That's how I would like to think of them as, like with Q or real coefficients and so on. So actually it is more intuitive to define homology groups. So think of them as, okay, so if you have a finite CW complex, so you will look at H0, h lower 0, h lower 1, and so on. So h lower 0, you always can think of as generated by cells in dimension 0. Because as I said that, at least for this nice compactified objects, it is going to be all these finitely generated abelian groups. Think of them as generated by cells in, or at least if you like topology, think of them as generated by subspace, closed subspaces in dimension 0, okay, H0. That means points here. And then you have to put some kind of an equivalence there. Because if you just look at a free abelian group generated by subspaces, so for H lowercase, I will mean that look at real, so these are real for the underlying manifold to be, which you consider as a real manifold. So when I mean subspaces, I mean the real closed subspaces. So H lower K, firstly, what do? You look at the free abelian group generated by K-dimensional closed subspaces. Okay? So look at the free abelian group generated by. So this is going to be very huge, right? Because you take something and just look at the K-dimensional closed subspaces. There would be infinitely thousands, millions, billions of them actually. And just look at the free abelian group, it is of no use. There is no way you can do anything about it. So you want to cut down the size of such a thing. How do you cut down the size of such a group? Put an equivalence relation. Put an equivalence relation where you collapse many of them together into one single equivalence class. So what is that equivalence you would put? So that is called as the homological equivalence. So this is same as saying that, okay, you have one closed K-dimensional cell and you have another K-closed dimensional cell. You want to say both of them are equivalent to each other. So they are equivalent to each other if and only if they can, this can be moved to this guy along a unit interval. Right? So that means, in other words, there should be some surface or a K plus one dimensional closed subspace, so that which is parameterized by a unit interval, so that at the zero point you start with this guy and it should collapse with the other one along a unit interval. So it should move here like this, so that what you get is a surface there. So this is the equivalence relation. Okay, so this is called as homological equivalence. So similar, so you put that equivalence relation on this free abelian group generated on closed K-dimensional subspaces. And once you do that, what you get is just your HK, homology. That's all. This is the one basic way to understand geometrically or topologically your homology groups. Okay. And then homology, think of its dual.
Ma'am, can we explicitly write every for every K, or it is difficult as we go higher and higher? I mean, the explicit description of this homology group.
So K, I mean that for any K actually, because I'm just restricting my attention to good topological spaces. So that means I just have look at finite CW complexes or manifolds, compact complex manifold, where I'm not interested in looking at arbitrary topological spaces. So where I need a notion of dimension there. So that's why I would look at, so at least what I have said intuitively, that is something you can assume it for good topological spaces or for compact complex manifolds. Where actually when this dual and all, actually you have Poincaré duality, all that makes very good sense actually.
Okay, so any more questions? If not, then let's thank the speaker once again.